Okay, if you turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 8. Anybody get an opportunity to read the text before this morning? Okay, good. I want to kind of just set it up here, first of all. So if we can show the map here of Palestine. Jesus spent the majority of his 3+ year ministry right here in the province of Galilee, which is just to the west of the Sea of Galilee. It was in Galilee where Jesus established his home base right here in Capernaum. And it was in Galilee where Jesus called his disciples. It was in Galilee where he performed most of his great miracles that we read about in Scripture. Located on the western side of the Sea of Galilee is this town called Magdala. It was there where Mary Magdalene came from. She's named at least 12 times in the Gospels as one of the women who traveled along with Jesus and his disciples. In the summer of 66 AD, 30 some years after Jesus' death, Jewish zealots rebelled against the Roman government in a guerrilla like warfare that would last 7 years and result in the Romans eventually destroying the temple in Jerusalem, as well as a good portion of Jerusalem itself in the year 70 AD. Now, in the spring of 67, the Roman army, commanded by Vespasian, laid siege to the cities in Galilee, including the city that I described, Magdala. Many rebels had gathered in Magdala because Magdala had walls around it that had been erected there to protect people and fortify it. So these rebels came to Magdala, but after a 6-week siege, they fled the city, went into boats. They were killed by the Romans, and Vespasian had the remaining residents of Magdala killed as well. And although there have been small settlements in that area in the 20th century since then, Magdala was never rebuilt. It was a forgotten city. Layers of soil and sand covered the city for 2,000 years. Several years ago, Father Juan Solana, the papal appointee in charge of Notre Dame, a highly rated guest house in Jerusalem, looks like a castle if you've ever seen it, he felt the leading of the Lord to build a retreat center somewhere along the shores of the Sea of Galilee. And during the mandatory archaeological tests that have to take place before any construction can occur, archaeologists unearthed in the year 2009 the only first century synagogue located on the Sea of Galilee, along with the archaeological remains of this 2,000-year-old city of Magdala. And our tour group was privileged to visit this holy site on February 28th of this year. And the neat thing is, as we are sitting there in the synagogue of Magdala, the individual brought to our attention Matthew chapter 4 and verse 23, which reads, Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness among the people. Which means this, that while we were sitting there in that synagogue in Magdala, we were at the very place where Jesus had taught, and he stood there. And this village is without a doubt a place where Jesus performed many of his great miracles. Magnificent chapel called the Duke in Altum was built there in that site, the first modern building, if you will, the new facility constructed in Magdala. It's been called by some, and I quote, the most unique spiritual center in the Holy Land. This place by itself is worth going into. And there in the middle is what's called the Women's Atrium. There are 8 pillars there in the center of that atrium, which represent 7 women in the Bible, including Mary of Magdala, and 1 pillar, which represents or honors women of faith across all time. Because Jesus had such a radically different opinion of women than did the cultures of his day, and even different than many cultures today and some religions today, because Magdala is the city where one of his most prominent female followers came from. Magdala is a perfect setting, and our text is a great example of how Jesus viewed women and treated women. So let's start first of all in Luke chapter 8, verse 1. Soon afterward, Jesus began a tour of the nearby towns and villages, preaching and announcing the good news about the kingdom of God. He took his 12 disciples with him, along with some women who had been cured of evil spirits and diseases. Among them were Mary Magdalene, from whom he had cast out 7 demons, Joanna, the wife of Chuza, Herod's business manager, Susanna, and many others who were contributing from their own resources to support Jesus and his disciples. Let's go to chapter 13 of Luke, verse 10. One Sabbath day, as Jesus was teaching in a synagogue, he saw a woman who had been crippled by an evil spirit. She had been bent double for 18 years and was unable to stand up straight. When Jesus saw her, he called her over and he said, "Dear woman, you are healed of your sickness." He touched her, and instantly she could stand straight. How she praised God. But the leader in charge of the synagogue was indignant that Jesus had healed her on the Sabbath day. "There are 6 days of the week for working," he said to the crowd. "Come on those days to be healed, not on the Sabbath." But the Lord replied, "You hypocrites! Each of you works on the Sabbath day. Don't you untie your ox or your donkey from its stall on the Sabbath and lead it out for water? This dear woman, a daughter of Abraham, has been held in bondage by Satan for 18 years. Isn't it right that she should be released even on the Sabbath?" This shamed his enemies. But all the people rejoiced at the wonderful things that Jesus did. If you take out your outlines there on the inside of the bulletin, since Jesus is our example in all things pertaining to life, we would be wise to imitate how? To imitate Jesus in how we treat women. And really, this is a great example on how we should treat people in general. So in verses 10 through 13, we see first of all that Jesus confirmed her dignity. How did he do that? Well, in verses 10 and 11, Jesus noticed her condition. We find the attitude, the Jewish attitude toward women in the first century, in some of the writings that preceded the time of Jesus, as well as some of the writings that followed the time of Jesus. For instance, in the Wisdom of Sirach, which was written 175 to 200 years before the time of Christ, appears in the Catholic books of the Apocrypha, we find these words: "From a woman, sin had its beginning, and because of her, we all die." Also, "Better is the wickedness of a man than a woman who does good. It is woman who brings shame and disgrace." The Jewish historian Josephus adds, quote, "The woman is inferior to the man in every way." And the Jewish Talmud tells us, 100 women are no better than 2 men." And so this explains why Jesus' disciples were surprised in John chapter 4 after they had gone to look for food, and they come back and they see Jesus talking with a woman. Men didn't have contact or communication with women in public. They just didn't do that. And to clarify, the Jewish view or attitude toward women was not much different than what it was across the entire world and in all cultures. And so while it's difficult for us to comprehend or understand The fact that Jesus took notice of this woman's condition, he saw her situation, and the fact that he moved to do something about it was highly unusual. Most men had just walked right on by this lady without saying a thing. The fact is, it really made Jesus' disciples uncomfortable. The number of times they witnessed Jesus healing women or teaching women or talking to them, it made them feel uncomfortable. In his book entitled Palestinian Judaism in New Testament Times, James Hurley writes, and I quote, "The most striking thing about the role of women in the life and teaching of Jesus is the simple fact they are there." Women were a prominent part of Jesus' ministry. They followed him, even as the men did. They provided the financial means for Jesus and his disciples to travel and to eat. It's no coincidence that even though women could not be legal witnesses in a court of law in the first century, it's no coincidence Jesus Christ chose women as the first witnesses to see him after his resurrection. Jesus spoke to women often, and when he did so with respect. He loved them unconditionally, even as he loves all people unconditionally. And in our text, Jesus didn't ignore this woman as so many other men had. Jesus didn't talk down to her. Jesus didn't try to pacify her with empty promises. He first noticed her condition. It was a huge thing just to recognize her condition. But then he did something more than that. Verses 12 through 13 tell us that Jesus met her needs. For 18 years, this woman had been unable to straighten up. For 18 years, she could not look toward heaven. For 18 years, she had given up on ever finding a cure for this condition. But Jesus not only noticed her condition, he did something about it. And our text tells us that when Jesus healed her, she stood straight up and she went ballistic with praise for God. And what's interesting is that as we read through the Gospels, we see this compassion Jesus had toward women. We see it on many occasions. We read about it just a little bit ago, and in Luke chapter 8, he tells us in verse 2 that Mary of Magdala had 7 demons cast out of her. Prior to her healing, Mary would have been shunned by both men and women, by both those who were religious and those who weren't religious. Prior to her healing in that condition, it would have been Jesus who had to have approached her. She could not have approached him. So on another occasion, when Jesus saw a widow in the village of Nain mourning for her only son, Jesus came, approached her, spoke to her, raised her son back to life again. Jesus healed Peter's mother-in-law in Capernaum and immediately allowed her to continue ministering to him. When a woman who was ceremonially unclean because she had been bleeding for 12 years touched Jesus, she was instantly healed. Jesus also raised to life the dead daughter of Jairus. The fact that a Jewish male made healing this many women a priority in his ministry was proof that Jesus saw them as valuable, and because he did, he treated them with dignity. It is a travesty against women today, young and old alike, that we often treat them as objects instead of people. In late 2014, a 20-year-old woman from just outside of Des Moines wanted to see some relatives on the East Coast. She accepted a ride from a 36-year-old man and his 31-year-old female companion. And over the next 3 weeks, experienced horror and torture, the likes of which I hope we never see. They chained her and dragged her on gravel roads. At times, they nailed her feet into the floor of the RV in which they were traveling. They would take keys and heat them really hot and then burn her flesh with them. And then they would pour bleach into her wounds. They threatened to slit her throat if she ever asked anyone for help. And for 3 weeks, as the RV moved from state to state, her sexual services were advertised on Craigslist. Not until a trucker noticed something unusual at a truck stop and phoned 911 was the young lady rescued, and those who rescued her said she would have died within 48 hours had he not intervened. Wanting to be proactive, thousands of semi-drivers across America have formed Truckers Against Trafficking to watch for this suspicious activity and report it. Since 2008, 425 cases involving nearly 1,000 women have been phoned in because individuals took notice and decided to do something. Before retiring from the Sex Trafficking Division of the Iowa State Patrol, Kurt Henderson said, as part of this division, that large numbers of pimps from all over the country annually bring their sex slaves to the Iowa State Fair. In Iowa? Yep. These crimes are happening all around us, and we don't even know it in many cases. Did you know there are Christian organizations like Rafa House that are going to other countries and rescuing women and young girls in the sex slave industry? At the North American Christian Convention a couple of weeks ago, Rachel Starr shared with us there are 5,000 women working in strip clubs in Kentucky. 70% of them are single mothers just trying to make ends meet. 60% do not have a high school diploma or GED. 80% were sexually or physically abused when they were young. 90% currently abuse drugs or alcohol. When Rachel became aware of what was going on, she took notice, like Jesus, and decided to do something. And so for 7.5 years, Rachel and her husband Josh have recruited and trained volunteers from the Southeast Christian Church in Louisville, Kentucky, who deliver meals to these women right there at the strip clubs where they work. And in those 7.5 years, more than 200 women have found Jesus Christ. And even one female club owner, seeing the unconditional love that Rachel and her team had for these individuals, one club owner sold her club, became a Christian. Christians in Dade, Broward, and Palm Beach counties in Florida are committed to helping widows and orphans. James told us in chapter 1, verse 27, pure religion cares about widows and orphans. These individuals took that seriously. Sheridan House Family Ministries offers individualized and intensive training to single mothers in areas such as finances and parenting and preparing a resume and interviewing for a job and planning meals on a budget and how to dress appropriately, and the list goes on and on. Individual Christians get involved with each of these individuals, And while they give away food, and yes, they give away clothing, the ministry is focused more on helping single moms with a hand up and not just a hand out. I think it's pretty obvious as we look at this text and other scriptures within the Gospels that the Lord doesn't want us just acknowledging the evil that goes on around us. He wants us actually doing something about it. No, we can't help everyone. We can't be there for every situation. I understand that. The question is, are we helping anyone? President Calvin Coolidge once said, quote, "We cannot do everything at once, but we can do something at once." Edward Everett Hale is credited for saying, "I am only one, but I am one. I cannot do everything, but I can do something, and I will not let what I cannot do interfere with what I can do." So whether it's rescuing women from the sex industry or pornography industry, whether it's equipping single mothers, whether it's parenting our daughters or loving our wives or just learning to relate to women in public the way that Jesus did, He is our divine example. And Jesus showed us the way to give women dignity is by noticing their conditions and their situations and helping them meet those needs with unconditional love. We see in verses 14 through 17, Jesus then affirmed her worth. How did he do that? Verses 14 and 15, Jesus first rebuked her critics. The leader of the synagogue was livid. "How dare you heal on the Sabbath?" What was the big deal? To us, that may not seem like a big deal, but some people are more concerned with obeying the rules of religion than they are developing a relationship with God. Because some people feel personally threatened if their rules aren't followed. And in the Pharisees' world, healing required a physician. And a physician was part of a profession. Therefore, healing and working were one and the same thing, and you should not heal on the Sabbath. And Jesus pointed out the synagogue leader's hypocrisy. When you untie an ox or a donkey and you lead it to water on the Sabbath, are you not working? You know, we all succumb to this religious hypocrisy sometimes, even sometimes when we know better. In Jesus' day, women were not to be taught the law by men. So when Jesus came to the house of Mary and Martha, Martha is out in the kitchen busy preparing the meal, and Mary is sitting there with the disciples and other men listening to Jesus teach. And Martha's upset. Either she's upset because Mary isn't there helping her prepare the meal, or she's upset because Mary is daring to sit there and listen to Jesus teach with the men, or maybe it was both. Martha pleads, "Lord, would you please tell Mary to get her rear end over here and help me with the food?" And how did Jesus respond? "Martha, what you're doing is important." I mean, I know. We all have to have food to be sustained physically. I understand that. But in all honesty, right now, Martha, right now, Mary's figured out what's most important. And if you want the truth, Martha, you should be learning from Mary, not her learning from you. But we just get into these rules sometimes. On another occasion, when a woman poured a large amount of expensive perfume on Jesus' head, His disciples wanted the Lord to rebuke this woman. How dare she waste that money and waste that expensive perfume? But Jesus was close to being crucified and dying, and Jesus rebukes his disciples instead. Guys, what this woman is doing is touching. And what she's doing will be told throughout the world and all of time. Now listen, the Bible tells us there is a time to be silent and there is a time to speak. Boy, it's difficult to figure out which is which, isn't it? So many times when we speak and we ought to be silent, and we're silent when we should speak. But Jesus knew when it was time to be silent and when it was time to speak out. There are times when the hypocrisy of our critics or someone else's critic, there's times when that hypocrisy needs to be confronted. Jesus had this lady's back, and he rebuked her critics. And there are times when we need to intervene on behalf of someone else who isn't able. Maybe it's our wife, or a coworker, or a friend, or maybe it's a total stranger. Somebody is being unfairly criticized or even attacked, and they need somebody to step there in the middle to have their back, which is exactly what Jesus did for this woman. And then we see in verses 16 and 17, Jesus recognized her value. You hypocrites. You hypocrites. Whether you guys want to hear it or not, this woman is a daughter of Abraham. She's every much a descendant of Abraham as any of you guys are. Are you really going to imply that your animals are more important than she is? Really? Are you seriously suggesting it's okay to untie your animals so they can get something to drink on the Sabbath, but it's not okay for me to untie this woman from the bondage that Satan has had over her for 18 years? Seriously? I don't know. Maybe I exaggerated more than Jesus did. I don't know. I couldn't help but thinking a few weeks ago that Jesus might have said the same thing to those people who were criticizing those Cincinnati zookeepers for killing that 17-year-old 450-pound silverback gorilla who was dragging that 3-year-old boy around in his compound. The boy had fallen into the compound. He's dragging it around. And people were criticizing the zookeepers for killing the animal. But what Jesus was trying to say then, and we need to recognize now, is that people are made in God's image. We are God's crowning, creative masterpiece. And Jesus said the Sabbath was made for the benefit of people. People were not created to meet the legalistic requirements of the Sabbath. Now, I don't know the tone or the inflection of Jesus' words there in verses 15 and 16, but they must have stuck, because Luke tells us in verse 17, all of Jesus' opponents were humiliated. They were ashamed of themselves, and they should have been. It's no accident that when Nicodemus, a man who was learned and knowledgeable in the Scriptures, when he wanted to know more about Jesus, what did he do? He went to meet him under the cover of darkness. We're not told that Nicodemus discussed this with anyone, what he and Jesus had talked about. On the other hand, the longest recorded discussion in the Bible is the one that Jesus had with a woman, an immoral woman, an immoral Gentile woman, an immoral Gentile Samaritan woman. Unlike Nicodemus, she ran to town. She told everybody about her discussion with Jesus, and as a result, they all came out of town, listened to Jesus, and ultimately, the Bible says they all believed because of the changes they saw in her and the passion of her testimony. In cultures where poverty abounds and males are dominant, female offspring are often regarded as a plague rather than a blessing. New census statistics from India show that the ratio of female to male children under the age of 6 years is steadily declining, a direct result of the rise in the abortion of unborn female babies and the neglect, unashamed neglect, of female children. It's far more costly to raise a girl in India than it is to raise a boy. The Associated Press reports, and I quote, "Families often go into debt arranging marriages and paying for elaborate dowries. A boy, on the other hand, will one day bring home a bride and a dowry." And even after they are born, Hindu customs greatly favor men over women. It's no different in Muslim cultures today. The problem has become so critical that hospitals in India are banned from revealing the gender of an unborn baby so as to prevent the parents from aborting girls. And furthermore, if a girl is born to parents in India, many give their daughters names with meanings that reflect their disappointment. How do you suppose a girl feels when she grows up with a name that reflects the fact her parents didn't want her? An organization in India called Save the Girl Child is now promoting renaming ceremonies. Just recently, they had such a ceremony in which 285 girls in India changed their names to the names of actresses in India or Hindu princesses. I'm not going to tell you anything you don't know, but all lives matter to Jesus Christ. All lives, female lives and male lives, black lives and white lives, Jewish lives and Arab lives, American lives and Russian lives, rich lives and poor lives, and the list can go on and on. All lives matter. So the Bible promises us this: if anyone is in Christ, he or she is a brand new creation. The old is gone, and the new has come. In Christ, we have a new name, a new purpose, and a new home. Jesus gives value to all those who choose Him. And consequently, the Apostle Paul says that for you and I who know Jesus, who live in Jesus, you and I should give respect and honor to those who deserve it. I'm just saying from my perspective as a Christian male, I know I must be more respectful and honoring of my wife, my daughter, my daughters-in-law, my granddaughters. And all girls and women. And furthermore, it's my desire that all of us guys who follow Jesus would follow His example and do the same. Because His treatment, His view of women in our text and in the Gospels is our example. Not just on how we should treat women, but really on how we should treat everybody. Everybody. So, do our words on a daily basis, do they reflect that all lives matter to us? Do our actions reflect that all lives matter to us? May we desire to see people and treat people in the same way that Jesus did, because when we do, you better believe the world will see and take notice.